Hello viewers, welcome to the video lectures for class 11th Economics. I'm Shweta Kathuria. Class 11th Economics syllabus comprises of Part A, Statistics for Economics, which carries a weightage of 40 marks, Part B, Indian Economic Development, which again carries a weightage of 40 marks, Open Textbook Assessment, which carries a weightage of 10 marks, and Project Work, again for 10 marks. Today, we'll be beginning with Indian Economic Development. Within that, we'll start with the very first chapter, which is Indian Economy on the Eve of Independence. In this chapter, we'll be discussing about the state of the Indian economy during the British rule and immediately after independence. Under this chapter, we'll be talking about how the British ruled over India and what was the condition of the Indian economy at the time of its independence. Now, we all know that the British ruled over India for about 200 years and excessively exploited the Indian resources for their own interest and turned a prosperous nation into a backward, dependent, and disintegrated economy. The sole purpose of the British colonial rule in India was to reduce the country into a feeder economy for Great Britain's rapidly expanding modern industrial base. Now, we all know that at this point of time when Britain was ruling over India, there was industrial revolution that was going on in Britain, and for those modern industries that were expanding in Britain, Britain needed raw material, and that raw material was being supplied from India. In this chapter, we'll talk about the major dimensions of the Indian economy on the eve of its independence. Under this, we talk about low level of economic development, the state of agricultural sector, Indian industries, and foreign trade on the eve of independence. Also, we'll be discussing about the state of infrastructure, occupational structure, and the demographic condition of the Indian economy at that point of time. Let's talk about how and why there was low level of economic development in India immediately after independence. The economic policies pursued by the colonial government in India were concerned more with the protection and promotion of the economic interest of their home country than with the development of Indian economy. Such policies brought about a fundamental change in the structure of the Indian economy, transforming the country into a net supplier of raw materials and a consumer of finished industrial products from Britain. During the first half of the 20th century, the aggregate real output was estimated to be around less than 2%, and per capita output was estimated to be around only 0.5%. Now, let's talk about the state of three economic sectors, which is agriculture, industry, and foreign trade. The state of agricultural sector. Indian agriculture showed a great sign of backwardness and stagnation on the eve of independence, which can be explained with the help of following points. The first one being low agricultural production. Despite being the occupation of a large section of population, that is around 85% of the Indian population was dependent on agriculture. Despite this fact, this sector continued to experience stagnation. Now, this meant that the agricultural production was quite low to meet the needs of the population, which was dependent on the agricultural sector as its occupation. At the time of independence, India's agricultural production was estimated to be around 50.8 lakh tons, which was quite low to meet the country's requirements. Secondly, we say that the agricultural sector was primitive in nature. Now, we all know primitive means backward in nature. At the time of independence, the agricultural productivity was quite low because of the lack of modern agricultural equipments, inputs, poor irrigation facilities, lack of high-yielding varieties of seeds, lack of pesticides, etc. Commercialization of agriculture. the British rule initiated commercialization of agriculture, whereby the farmers were forced to grow cash crops instead of food crops. These cash crops were either used for sale in the market or were being used by the British industries back home. Of course, these cash crops were being used by the British industries in the form of a raw material, right? Let's talk about land settlement system. One of the major cause of the stagnation of agricultural sector was the introduction of land settlement system by the British. Under this system, there existed an intermediary class, that is the zamindars, that existed between the British government and the peasants or the actual tillers. This zamindari class had been appointed by the British to collect revenue from the peasants regardless of their economic conditions, which led to immense misery and social tension among the farmers. Huge growth in agricultural indebtedness. Now, due to low productivity in the agricultural sector and implementation of the land settlement system or the zamindari class, peasants were under debt, which added to their miseries. Debt was created because of the fact that the peasants had to pay taxes to the zamindars irrespective of the fact whether there was good rainfall, good production or not. Now, let's talk about the state of Indian industries on the eve of independence. India could not develop a sound industrial base under the colonial rule. Britishers systematically destroyed Indian handicraft industry and no modern industrial base was allowed to come up. The growth rate of the agricultural sector and its contribution towards GDP was very small, estimated to be around only 10%. Remember, we're talking about the growth rate of the agricultural sector and its contribution towards GDP. Contribution towards GDP means how much this industrial sector was contributing towards the income generation in the Indian economy. And see, it was only around 10%, which means that the production and the growth of the industrial sector was quite low. The state of Indian industries can be explained with the help of the following points. First, deindustrialization of the Indian economy. Deindustrialization means no industrialization of the Indian economy. The colonial government deindustrialized the Indian economy. The primitive motive behind this was twofold. First, to reduce India into a mere exporter of raw materials for the upcoming modern industries in Britain. And secondly, to turn India into a sprawling market for the finished goods coming from the British industries. Now, of course, we all understand that the British deindustrialized the Indian economy in order to protect and promote their own industries back home. Otherwise, who would buy their products in India? This is a very, very important point from the exam point of view, right? Now, let's talk about the second point, which is decline of the traditional Indian handicraft industry. Due to the discriminatory policy followed by the colonial government, India experienced decline of the handicraft industry, which led to massive unemployment in the industrial sector. Now, this caused migration from the urban area back to the villages, which made the agricultural sector overburdened. Of course, all those people who had been displaced from the Indian handicraft industry had no jobs to do. And so they migrated back to the rural areas where agricultural sector was their major occupation. And that is why the agricultural sector, which was already engaging a large section of the population, became overburdened. That is why, remember, we talk about disguised unemployment in the agricultural sector or the primary sector. Secondly, it led to rise in the import of cheap manufactured goods from Britain. So, here we talked about the decline of Indian handicraft industry. It had a twofold impact on the Indian economy. One, because of the decline of Indian handicraft industry, there was migration from the urban to the rural areas, making the agricultural sector overburdened. And secondly, it led to rise of the import of cheap manufactured goods from Britain. Of course, the machine-made goods that were coming from Britain were cheaper in comparison to the handmade goods in India. Let's talk about the existence of only a few consumer goods industries in India now. During the second half of the 19th century, modern industries began to take root in India, but it was confined only to the setting up of cotton and jute textile mills. After the Second World War, few industries came up like sugar and paper industry. Lack of capital goods industries. Now here we need to understand the meaning of capital goods industries. I hope we all know that capital goods are those goods which help in the further process of industrialization. That means capital goods are those goods which help in the further process of production. Now, since there were hardly any capital goods industries in India to promote the industrialization, the country had to depend on other nations for the requirements of capital goods. Limited operation of the public sector. Another significant drawback of the new industrial sector was the very limited area of operation of the public sector. Now, public sector means the government sector, where the ownership and control is in the hands of the government. Now remember, at this point of time, we had the British government and not the independent India, right? So this sector remained confined only to railways, power generation and communication, which were of interest to the British. So till now, we have discussed about low level of economic development, the state of agricultural sector and the state of Indian industries on the eve of independence. We discussed that under the colonial dispensation, the economic policies of the government were concerned more with the protection and promotion of the British interest than with the need to develop the economic condition of India and its people. We also discussed that the agricultural sector continued to experience stagnation and deterioration despite the fact that the largest sector of the Indian population depended on it for sustenance. Then we discussed that the rule of the British government led to the collapse of the India's world famous handicraft industries without contributing in any significant manner to its replacement by a modern industrial base. I hope now you would be able to answer the following questions. Question 1. What was the focus of the economic policies pursued by the colonial government in India? What were the impacts of these policies? Remember, we talked about twofold motive and the feeder economy, how India was converted into a feeder economy. Question 2. What were the main causes of agricultural stagnation in India during the colonial period? Question number 3. What was the twofold motive behind the systematic deindustrialization effected by the British in pre-independent India? Now, this question is very important from exam point of view. Remember, twofold motive was first to make India a net supplier of raw materials for the British industries, and second, to convert India into a sprawling market for the British finished goods. Question number 4. Name some modern industries which were in operation in our country at the time of independence. So, in today's lecture, we've talked about the low level of economic development, the state of agricultural sector and the state of Indian industries on the eve of independence. In our next lecture, we'll be talking about the state of foreign trade, infrastructure, occupational structure and the demographic condition of the Indian economy at the time of independence. Thank you. See you again.